What's going on, everybody? My name is Jason, and this is Tennessee Mountain Homestead. Today, we're back out in the shop working on the John Deere 214 mud mower. We got a ton of parts in the mail, and I'll show you guys in a minute. We'll get into it. So we got a ton of parts in the mail recently. I got a carburetor from Go Power Sports, the Makuni. I got a BMI disc brake kit. And before we get into that stuff, I want to do a quick update on what I've done since with the clutch mechanism and a couple other things on the tractor. So give me a second, we'll get into it. So this is the clutch mechanism that I fabricated that lives in the belly of the tractor. So all we've done to it, we took it out and we painted it because it was just all raw steel. And I also had to clearance, I had to open up this slot in the top of it because this shift quadrant, when it sits on the tractor, there's this mechanism back here, there's a spring and some other stuff back here that when it bolts down to the tractor, to the frame, the spring protrudes through in the bottom of this quadrant selector, protrudes through, and it would have interfered with this, so I had to cut a relief here. Other than that, that's where this thing's at. Also, this is where the idler pulley for the clutch mechanism rides. And what I've done to this is instead, these are shaft collars. And before, when I didn't know where they were gonna be exactly, they were just held on by these set screws. There's one on each side of each lever. So I had two set screws. And that would never have been strong enough to withstand the forces of the clutch pulling on it and the spring. I mean, it stayed, but so anyway, what I did was I drilled completely through, threaded it for 5/16, and now on each one shaft collar has a 5/16 bolt threaded completely through. And on the other shaft collar, I just took out the set screw, I took a drill bit, and I drilled down into the shaft just a little bit so that when I put the set screw back in there, now it's going into a dimple in the steel. So that's super strong, that ain't going nowhere. And let me regroup and we'll be right back. So the other piece that I made a few weeks back was this adjustable idler pulley. Adjustable idler pulley mechanism. Anyway, all we did was take it off and we painted it. So come over here. So as you can see in the tractor, it's pretty much gutted. The clutch mechanism lives here. The idler pulley piece, the adjustable piece, lives here. And one more thing I wanted to show you before we talk about the carburetor is this right here. Can you get in here? The last thing I wanted to show you people is right here. So you can see we've gutted the tractor. All the parts are over there on the bench. The clutch mechanism, the idler pulley thing that lives here. And now here is another idler pulley. This is the one on the top side of the belt that keeps it off of the frame. Comes off the engine pulley and goes down to this pulley here. And as you can see, instead of just having a bolt with just 2 5/8 nuts squeezing it, holding it, standing off, what I did was I welded the base of that nut. That's still a grade 8 5/8 bolt. And what I did was I bolted it in place how it used to be. I welded that nut to the frame, welded the shaft collar to it, the inside shaft collar. And then I used little pieces of, I guess this is probably 5/16 rod. It was some lever off of this tractor that I cut up, and I gave it like gussets here. So that's ultra strong. Come over here. And this is what it looks like on the outside. No more nut. I used a 5/8 Unistrut square washer that I use at work all the time. Plug welded the bolt through it and welded around the edge. And this thing, that idler pulley shaft should be just fine. So next, we're gonna get back over there and we're gonna start diving into the carburetor. See you in a minute. So as you can see on the table here, we've got some parts. We talked about that stuff over there, but that just got painted and modified slightly. So the most exciting thing we have here is this Makuni carburetor. I got it from Performance 670. It came with this nice billet aluminum manifold. It came with this this clamp that goes on the carburetor that bolts to this manifold. That's what's going to hold the carburetor on. Came with some little pieces and parts, the bolts for the manifold, and the bolts to hold this onto this. That's what it came with. So it's a 34 millimeter flat slide carburetor. I got an air filter from eBay, and I got a remote choke cable for it. Hopefully it's long enough. I didn't realize it was going to be so short. We'll see. And I got a throttle cable. And we'll be back in a minute. Okay, so the second thing I got that's equally as exciting as the carburetor was I got this MCP brake kit, and it's made here in the USA. I got it from BMI Carts. It came with this master cylinder, caliper, some nylon brake line, which I'm not sure if I'm gonna use this or go with steel. That's probably this for getting it mocked up and see if it even works. You know, we'll get it working. Maybe I'll change the steel in the future, don't know. I did go back and I got a brake bleeder kit for it. It came with brake fluid, and I believe that's all it came with. Oh no, it came with these. When I bought it, it came with this. I chose the 7-inch brake rotor, and unfortunately, this is just—it's 9/32 of an inch too big around in diameter to fit on the transmission because it hits the axle. So when I ordered this thing, I also ordered a 6-inch disc brake rotor. Now, unfortunately, neither one of these is going to work. At first, I thought I was just going to take this and have this machine down 9/32 of an inch, but my problem is that I didn't realize that it was going to have this go-kart hub. I've never ordered anything like this before. I've never had a go-kart with disc brakes. So all this stuff's new to me. And so it has this hub that bolts to either one of these. The problem is that this caliper, if I want it to be all the way so it makes contact with the rotor and it engages both pads, the entire pad, it can't turn because it's going to hit this hub. Now, it'll be the same way on this one too. I won't get full contact and the hub's gonna hit the rotor. So, what I did was I went back to Go Power Sports and I got a 6-inch rotor. It's a steel one, it has slots, and it's just, instead of having a hub that bolts to it, it's just got like a steel hub that's welded to the rotor. So that's still coming in the mail. I haven't gotten it yet. Hopefully it'll be here sometime this week. Let me regroup and we'll come right back. So another thing I got was this heavy duty brake and throttle pedal kit from Go Power Sports. It came with both of these. It came with these bolts, shoulder bolts I think they're called. But anyway, and it came with some return springs and some pedal stops according to Go Power Sports. That's what they're listed as, excuse me. So this is going to hopefully be my gas and my brake pedal on the tractor. And I also ordered from eBay, I got a tachometer. Because we're taking the governor out of that 670, and we're going to have this slide carburetor on it. And so I don't have any other engine parts yet, as far as like, you know, the billet rods and all the good stuff that makes so they can spin way faster than stock. So I think that it can safely spin to about 4,000 RPMs-ish. And we want to make sure that we don't exceed that because I don't want to blow that thing up. Be back in a minute. All right, so one thing I did want to, that I appreciate, when I ordered from BMI Carts, they sent this little odd looking booklet. And at first I was like, what in the world's this? I opened it up and I appreciated to see that this is the Gospel of John. Pretty cool. People over there at BMI are some good people. And they also sent this here. It's a BMI event center for Salis, Ohio. And this is a schedule of like some concerts and things that's going on. Christmas in July, some concerts. So it looks like some religious bands. But on 9/16 of this year, we're gonna get the Kentucky Headhunters and Confederate Railroad. I might have to be there for that one. We might have to be there. We got Clay Walker on 9/23. 9:30, we got Quiet Riot, pretty cool. I saw them in 1999 in Fort Lauderdale, down on the beach on A1A. Or that might have been 98. Anyways, 10/7, Stephen Piercy, the voice of Rat, Round and Round, you know, good band. Queensryche, a Journey tribute band, looks like a Lynyrd Skynyrd tribute band, that's in November. You know, it's just pretty cool. Pretty cool that they went to that extent, you know. And I was happy to see that in the mail. So anyways, let's get into some more stuff. All right, guys. So with all the showcasing out of the way, you saw my new parts, you saw what we've done off camera. Now, let's get into the meat and potatoes of this video. So, we're going to remove this from the tractor. It's just been on here to mock it up. We're gonna take this engine, we're gonna put it over on the workbench, and we're gonna start disassembling it. Now, there's a lot of videos on YouTube that I've been watching and doing research on. None of this stuff comes with instructions, but as usual, I'm just gonna wing it. So we need to take off the air cleaner, the old carburetor, this cover, probably the whole entire engine cover. I don't know yet, we'll see. And to remove the governor, we gotta take the back of the engine off, the cover plate on the backside where the crankshaft is, where the pulley rides. Anyway, that's what we got. We're gonna shoot some footage of taking this thing out, and once it's on the bench, we'll be back with you. All right, quick update. We're taking the engine off the tractor, and this came in the mail. This is the fuel pump for that Mikuni carburetor. Because in the description at 670, Performance 670, about the carburetor, they did some modification to it where it's going to require a fuel pump. So this is a 12-volt small engine fuel pump I got from eBay. Just wanted to give a quick update because it just came in the mail right now. Ready to start tearing this thing apart to get the carburetor installed and the governor out, but I need a little refresher. A little help from my man at Redbeard's Garage. Awesome channel. Anything you want to know about go-karts, that's the place to go. And he does a great job with his Predator builds. So we're gonna get a little refresher and we'll be back. We got the engine torn down, we got the cover off, the gasket got destroyed, and I did look for gaskets online for these things, and I can't find them on there. They seem to be nowhere. Just this cover gasket. But from what I've seen on other similar builds, if you don't reuse the factory gasket and you use RTV, you got to get a different spacer that fits up here on for the crankshaft in play. So unfortunately, that gasket, just taking this thing off, the gasket ripped and it's broken. So it's useless. And it's been, having a good time, party, no big deal. We thought it was going to be a cut and dry thing. Nope, it's not, because I need to tap this where the governor was. I got to tap it out to 3/8-16. And to do that is not a big deal, but the camshaft's in the way. So now I got to take off the rocker arm covers, take the rocker arms loose, so I can relieve tension on the valve train in order to be able to pull this camshaft out. And we got the oil level sensor in here has got to come out. That's no big deal. And we got to tap that bottom one to 7/16-20. What is it? What's the size? 7/16. Yeah, 7/16-20. But to do that, we got to remove the starter, which isn't a big deal. And then I don't know what this vent is. This went to the carburetor. I don't know if that's the PCV or if this is the PCV. Don't know. Anyway, we're gonna get back to it, do some more research, and I'll let you know what happens. All right, quick update. I took off the rocker arms on both sides and took the push rods out and the lifters. And I have them over here laid out on the bench exactly how they were. It wasn't too bad, not as bad as I thought it was going to be. I took the camshaft out, and now we have access so we can tap this governor arm hole. And then the next thing we got to do is take off the starter, and so we can get the oil sensor out of it so we can tap that out. So we're going to go ahead and work on that, and we'll catch up with you in a few more minutes. Okay, so a quick update. This is the positive. This is the PCV right here. What I'm going to end up having to do is, once the carburetor is on here, I'm going to have to put a nipple in the side of this intake filter so that it gets crankcase ventilation. I looked at a bunch of different videos, and no one says this right here. I believe is a reference for the fuel for the mechanical fuel pump, for the pulse pump or whatever. So this here, I'm just going to unscrew that and cap it. I don't need that because I'm going to be running an electric pump. We do need this, and I'm going to try to incorporate it. If I have to get a longer hose or whatever, I don't know. I haven't put the carburetor on yet. But theoretically, this is going to be plugged into the air filter to give us our ventilation. Otherwise, we're pretty good. We're going to start reassembling this in a few minutes, and we'll let you know how that goes. We're going to go ahead and tap this out to 3/8-16. Since it's aluminum, I don't need to back it up and break the chip. It just goes nice and easy. And we got this packed with a bunch of rags to catch all these chips. You don't want none of that going in the motor. It's completely through. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and put a bolt in this, and then we're gonna tap the next one out. Be back in a minute. We got the holes both tapped. I did end up going with 7/16-14 thread pitch, not 20 like was on Redbeard did. I'm using a 14 because this is what I got. It's a leftover cap screw from when I bought them for the to bolt the belt keeper around the pulley on this engine. So 7/16-14, I put some Teflon plumber's tape on it to seal it. And we're gonna go ahead and thread that in. That's 3/8-16. I put a washer. It's also got Teflon plumber's tape on it. We're gonna go ahead and crank these things in there. I unscrewed this fitting here that used to go to the pulse pump. I'm just gonna go to the hardware store and get a brass plug for this. I'm not sure the thread pitch, probably some National Pipe Thread thing, I don't know. Eighth inch or something, I don't know. But I'm gonna get a plug for that. And we're gonna go ahead and get this thing bolted back together. I'm gonna have to go ahead and order the bigger shims from Predator 670 because I can't find a gasket. I'm not going to make a gasket because I don't know the thickness. We're going to go ahead and use RTV to put this cover back on, and I'm going to have to just bolt it back on temporarily with no gasket and no oil. It ain't going to be running anytime soon anyway. So we're going to get this thing all bolted back together, and we'll see you soon. Almost forgot to take the governor gear out of here. So I just got done watching Redbeard do it. Seems like you pretty much just got to just pry it out of here. There we go. And there's a little clip down in there. I ended up getting this governor gear out of there. It wasn't as easy as it looks on Redbeard's video. There's this little clip, I don't even know what to call it, a little clip, and it just spins around on the shaft. You try to pry it with a screwdriver, it just spins, and these little doodads just get in the way. But anyway, we got it out, and don't forget about the little washer either. So we're getting ready to bolt on the new intake manifold, or this carb adapter. And it comes with this little set screw, and there's no instructions. All the stuff that I'm finding out, I watched other people do it. But there's this little set screw, I got some Loctite on it, and it goes in this, look over here. It goes in this hole right here, right in the middle. And I guess that's to block air from leaking, any vacuum leaks in there. So we're gonna go ahead and thread this down in there. Okay, so the set screw's down in there. This is the original gasket and spacer. I guess this is an insulating spacer to not transfer heat to the carburetor, I'm guessing. But these are still in perfect condition. Thankfully, I don't have to buy new ones or try to find any. So that goes just like that. And we're gonna have our carburetor is gonna be facing inboard on the engine. So the hole for the carburetor is gonna be facing this way. And it comes with four socket cap screws. It's almost like it was made for this because the original carburetor only has three bolts. It uses these two on the outside facing outwards and then that one in the middle where that little blank socket screw goes in. So it has two extra threaded holes and I don't know why they did that, but this works out pretty good. So just like that, we'll tighten those bolts on and we'll come back in a minute. Okay, on second thought, the last thing you saw me doing was bolting the manifold down to this through this. It's got this plastic spacer, but once I got the bolts run down in there, apparently there was only a couple of threads engaged. And when I went to tighten it down, I was just going easy. 1, 2, 3, 4, and like a cross pattern. And this one just immediately, it ripped out the top thread because I guess it only had a couple threads in there. So, of course there's no instructions. I guess I don't need the spacer. Either that or I gotta go find some longer cap screws, but I thought Performance 670 would have that included, the right length. So I guess I'm just gonna use one of these gaskets. And I guess there's no heat transfer because even if this gets hot, you still got this. The carburetor is going to be bolted to this, clamped on there, so that'll be your insulator for the heat transfer. I don't know. Anyway, I thought I'd share that because that was kind of disappointing. But yeah, I guess we're going to see how this works instead without that plastic spacer on it. I can already see I got a lot more thread engagement than I did before. So let me bolt this on. We're gonna see how the carburetor fits, and I'll be back in a minute. I got the carburetor mounted. Everything seems to work without that spacer, without this spacer right here. I guess you don't want this on there. Dang near destroyed my threads in my manifold, but it only peeled off the top one, and I was able to run this bolt in there with my fingers, so it wasn't a big deal. And now it's got probably 3/8 of an inch at least of engagement, maybe even more. So that's nice and tight. I didn't crank down nothing, because nothing as far as I can tell right now is going to be finalized. Obviously, like I said before, I don't have a gasket or RTV on this because I need to get the different shims, apparently. before I can RTV that cover back on there. So we just have these bolts just barely snug. I put the dipstick back in. This is to keep dirt out of it for now. The manifold's bolted on there. These are not torqued. These bolts, they're just snug. They're nice. They're tight, but they're not torqued. I don't know what the torque spec is. The carburetor's on there, clamped on there. I still need to take the top of the carburetor out to put my throttle cable on there. Not doing that now. This filter's just sitting on there. I have the choke. So the choke's right here. The choke's manual on this right now. That's your choke on this Mikuni carburetor. I gotta unbolt that and put the remote cable on there for the dashboard. Ain't doing that right now. This is just kind of mock-up, but we got a governor delete. That was one of our main missions. So the governor's gone out of there. We got our oil sending unit, that's plugged up. The governor arm hole is plugged up. The carburetor is mounted on there for now. It looks great. This is the crankcase ventilation tube. What I'm gonna do is tomorrow I'm gonna go to the auto parts store and I'm going to drill a hole in this filter and see about what I can find for a brass fitting. I need maybe a 90 degree bung or whatever I find that's gonna fit in this hose. That's gonna go on there, clamp on there, and then this is gonna go on that barb fitting, hopefully. And that's gonna suck in, give me my vacuum on my crankcase. So, apart from that, that's what we planned on doing today. And give me a few more minutes and we're gonna go ahead and sign off. So I just wanted to make sure this was gonna clear under the hood, and it will. So I've got 22 inches, I put the hood on the mower. I got from my engine plate to the bottom of the hood inside, I got 22 inches. And so that's way up here. So this cable, my throttle cable for this carburetor is gonna easily be able to have enough room where it's not bent over tight. I'm just thinking about this stuff, but so I don't have to lose any sleep over that tonight. So I know we're clear on that. And we'll see you in a minute. All right, guys, that's gonna be it for today's video. Hope you guys had a good time watching this. If you're following, please like and subscribe. I'd appreciate that. You know, we have a lot of fun making these videos, and likes and subscribes and even comments, even if it's negative, I don't care. All that stuff adds to it so that, you know, more people will see this stuff. Anyways, guys, I really appreciate everything. All the likes and the subscriptions I've been getting lately. So these videos started off, you know, pretty upbeat, pretty up-tempo. Destroying this stuff, that's my specialty. I love to tear stuff up. But now we're at the part of this build where it's getting a lot more intricate. Stuff I ain't never done before, getting all these parts and everything else coming in the mail. Some of it works, some of it hasn't worked. But, you know, bear with me, it's going to get better. We're gonna get this thing running, and it should be really cool. So the videos are becoming more intricate as we get into more complex things like air, fuel, and, you know, wiring and all that stuff. But I'm going to see this thing through. This tractor here will be cool. So anyways, guys, once again, I'm Jason, Tennessee Mountain Homestead. I really appreciate it, and we'll see you later.